Namaste dear learners, today we will discuss one of the topics in optional English paper first, BA fifth semester Rani Chennamma University Belagavi. Introduction to criticism, origin and meaning of the term criticism. English word criticism is derived from the ancient word Greek word kritikos, which means to judge or evaluate. The Greek word kritikos and Latin word criticus are the source of English word criticism. The Greek term originated as early as in the 4th century BC. In the 4th century BC, Aristotle wrote the Poetics. In the book, he criticizes many of his contemporary literary works and also describes the forms of arts and concepts like tragedy and comedy. Aristotle is known as the father of literary criticism. It was Dryden who first used the word criticism in print, at least, and in the now familiar sense of any formal discussion of literature. The words critic and critical were existed in the English language from the 16th century itself. John Dryden was the first person to use the word criticism in its modern sense in his preface to the State of Innocence, wherein he writes, "Criticism, as it was first instituted by Aristotle, was meant a standard of judging well. Criticism cannot exist without creation. Creation comes first and criticism next. The function of criticism is to interpret and to judge literary works in an unbiased and dispassionate manner, so that the creative writers produce excellent works and the readers enjoy literature in an enlightened manner." Abercrombie writes, "Criticism enables the man who has the energy to create literature to make the most intelligent and therefore the most efficient use of his energy. And just so criticism enables the man who has the capacity to enjoy literature to make his enjoyment the most intelligent and therefore the most discriminating and most illuminating kind of experience. Criticism is thus distinct from creation and enjoyment and consists in asking and answering rational questions about literature." A publication of Alexander Pope's essay on criticism in the year 1711, the word criticism was firmly established in English literature. The 17th and 18th century, the critic was considered a judge who finds the faults and merits of a literary work. By the second half of the 19th century, criticism became more philosophic and it started literary criticism is considered to be the evaluation analysis, description, or interpretation of literary works. Criticism is the conscious evaluation or appreciation of a work of art, either according to the critic's personal state or taste, or according to some accepted aesthetic ideas. Increasingly, it is stated, as it was always implied, that to set up as a critic is to set up as a judge of values. In Encyclopedia Britannica, Edmund Gosse defines criticism as the art of judging the qualities and values of an aesthetic object. Criticism examines a particular literary work, or may look at an author's writing as a whole. Finding literary criticism can be a challenge. Definitions of criticism will make our job easy to understand. What is criticism? According to Matthew Arnold, criticism is a disinterested endeavor to learn and propagate the best that is known and thought in the world, and thus to establish a current of fresh and true ideas. According to Matthew Arnold, criticism is a disinterested activity which brings about the best that is known and thought in the world. Literary criticism is the formal study and discussion of works of literature, for example, by judging and explaining their importance and meaning. J.C. Ransom defines criticism as an act of defining and enjoying the aesthetic characteristics of literature. Criticism is the art of interpreting art. It serves an intermediary between the author and the reader by explaining the one to the other. According to Waterpater, literary criticism interprets art, and it is also a kind of art, and it is an agent between the author and the reader. And criticism explains one to the other. It explains the writer to the reader and reader to the writer. According to T.S. Eliot, criticism is the commendation and exposition of works of art by means of written words. Another important 20th century critic, René Wellek, defines criticism as: literary criticism is the most widely accepted sense in judgment of books, reviewing and finally the definition of state of the tradition of what is a classic. According to René Wellek, the basic function of criticism is to bring about the classic literature. Next, we will discuss the nature of criticism. The various definitions which we have discussed till now gives us a hint to understand the complex nature of criticism. Criticism is nothing but a study, discussion, evaluation, analysis, description, and interpretation of a literary work, or it is a kind of judgment about a piece of literature. Literary criticism is nothing but the evaluation of literary works, which includes the classification of genre, analysis of structure, and judgment of value. literary criticism is always guided by three important principles. They are the principle of truth and beauty, the principle of symmetry, the principle of idealism. The nature of criticism depends upon the following factors. First one is influence of literary theories. Second one is every age has given literature new critical theory. For example, in Restoration age we have neoclassical theory, and in Romantic age we have Romanticism, and in Victorian age we have realism, and in modernism we have psychological criticism. This is how every age of literature has given a different kind of literary theory to the world. Along with age, standard of judgment and evaluation changes. According to the age, the standards of judgment and evaluation go on changing. Criticism is always influenced by literary theories of that particular era. And we can see the influence of the age of and literature of that time on literary theory also, literary criticism also. Literature, as we know, holds a mirror to the society, and in reflection, criticism holds a mirror to the literature. If the literature represent the social changes, criticism represents the change in form, structure, and method of narration. From ancient to modern age, literature has completely changed in content, style, theme, narration, and technique. There has been a lot of changes which have taken place in literature, and those changes are represented by criticism. The things which are once treated as unimportant might have become important at present. In the earlier ages, work of art was judged with set standard of literature, but today there is a kind of connection between psychology, sociology, anthropology, modernity, and gender issues. Criticism is highly influenced by the age in which it is produced, like that of literature. Now we will discuss the functions of criticism. What are the functions of criticism? About this, different people express different opinions. People are completely have different opinions about the functions of criticism and the role of a critic. According to the classical writers, the critic is considered to be the lawgiver whose main function is to instruct the writers how to write and to lay down certain rules which they must follow. According to classical writers, a critic has to propagate some of the rules for the writers to write their creative works. The opposite view is that the function of criticism is to interpret, to enlighten, and to judge a work of art and literature. There are some people who hold that job of a critic is to propagate methods of writing, and at the same time there are some people who believe that the function of critic is to interpret, evaluate and judgment. The first function of criticism is training of the writers. According to the classicists, the function of criticism is to teach the writer how to write, what to write, when to write. They thus constructed dogmatic principles based on the generalizations of Aristotle and Horace. The classicists propagated their principles of literary evaluation based on Aristotle and Horace. The principles were founded on a dispassionate analysis of ancient classics of Greece and Rome. The critics of ancient time aimed at analyzing the ancient works of classical works of Greece and Rome. The general statements of Aristotle and Horace were narrowed down to dogmatic rules, and the writers were advised to follow them strictly. The rules and conditions which were founded by Aristotle and Horace. The neoclassicists and the Augustans were firmly of the opinion that the main aim of criticism was to devise rules for the guidance of writers and then to judge a work on the basis of these principles. The neoclassicists also believed that job of a critic is to promulgate rules to writing a creative work. Dryden, Alexander Pope and Dr. Johnson were the stern advocates who judged poets and their creations on the basis of these rules. The people who completely, properly followed these rules are John Dryden, Alexander Pope, and Dr. Johnson. The English poets of Renaissance, with the singular exception of Ben Jonson, did not observe these rules, and so they pre-prom the tyranny of rules could create literary works of a very high order. And there were some poets who believe that there should not be any rules, and they thought that such rules bind the creative power of a poet, and that is the reason why they tried to come out of that rule. The second function of criticism is interpretation and judgment of literature. As we know, the first and foremost function of criticism is the interpretation of art and literature. According to Carlyle, criticism stands like an interpreter between the inspired and the uninspired, between the prophet and those who hear the melody of his words and catch some glimpse of their material meaning, but understand not deeper import. According to Thomas Carlyle, the function of criticism is like a middleman, an agent. it has to convey the meaning of a book to the reader, and it is like an interpreter, an intermediary between a prophet and the common man. It implies that the critic must explain the full meaning and value of a work of art to readers who cannot grasp it without his help. Common readers may not be able to grasp the meaning of a literary work on their own, and that's where the job of a critic starts. A critic has to help the reader to understand the work of art. The purpose of a critic is to penetrate to the heart of the book before him. The important purpose of the critic is to penetrate into the heart of the book to understand the essential qualities of beauty, power, and appeal. The critic has to find out the qualities of beauty, power, and how it appeals to the readers, and to distinguish between what is permanent and temporary in it. The critic has to bring about the permanent and temporary factors of a book, thus by explaining, unfolding, illuminating, the critic shows us what the book really is in its entirety. The critic, by doing a different kind of explanations, unfoldings, illuminatings, try to make us to understand a literary work. According to Helen Gardner, elucidation or illumination is the critic's primary task as I conceive it. Thus, the function of criticism is to furnish exposition and description. Criticism must enable the reader to feel concretely what is being described. The main task of the critic, according to Cecil Day Lewis, is easing or widening, deepening our response to poetry, or one must add to whatever other branch of literature he may have chosen as his special duty. The next and last function of criticism is enlightenment. The enlightenment is the primary functions of criticism. It has to enlighten the masses and to create an ideal atmosphere for the development and nourishment of culture. Literature has a responsibility of nourishing and developing culture of a particular society. Criticism, according to Matthew Arnold, is a disinterested endeavor to learn and propagate the best that is known and thought in the world. Criticism must embrace all the branches of knowledge like theology, philosophy, history, art, languages, and science. Then only criticism can be valuable. And to make the best ideas prevail in the world, criticism must help to promote or provoke good ideas in the world, from which the creative writers may derive inspiration to literature of a very high order of excellence. By the standards or the interpretation of literature, the creative writers must be inspired, must get inspiration to write great works of art. The next thing is good qualities of a critic. Now we will discuss the good qualities of a critic. A critic's task is very difficult. First and foremost, let us know that it is a difficult task to be a critic. The critic has to play many roles. The poet has only one role to play. He writes it and forgets it. But it is the job of a critic to interpret it and give meaning to the words on a page. The critic corrects our tastes. The critic functions a job of correcting our tastes of literature, and he tries to justify our tastes, and sometimes he is able to create new kind of tastes among the readers. In order to master his craft, he needs a special training. A critic must be a trained person. His success depends greatly upon a natural aptitude for it. Critic has to be a born critic, like that of a born poet. In short, only an exceptionally qualified and gifted man can perform his task well. To be a critic, you must be exceptionally qualified and you must be gifted with some kind of energy. The first quality of a good critic is, a critic must be a man of wide and varied learning. A critic must read a lot. He must be a learned person, because only when he is a voracious reader, he can have sufficient materials on which to base his judgments. If the poet is a voracious reader, then only he can base his judgments. In order to have proper standards of evaluation, he must be thoroughly acquainted with the great authors in several languages. A critic needs to read several authors from different languages. He should not stick on to only one language. Rather, he has to read literature from different languages. According to Matthew Arnold, the first great requisite for a critic is the acquisition of knowledge, and ever fresh knowledge. He says that every critic should try and possess one great literature at least besides his own, and the more unlike his own the better. Matthew Arnold, being one of the greatest critics of Victorian period, is of the opinion that if you want to become a critic, you should be acquainted with another language, with your own language. Thus, it means that we are supposed to study two languages, then only we can become good critics. T.S. Eliot regards the whole of European literary tradition from the beginning down to his own day as one tradition, and enjoins on the critic to acquire as much of it as he can. It is only such knowledge that can enable the critic to judge particular works in a proper perspective. Secondly, a critic must have proper training and technical skill. A critic must be properly trained, and he must have some technical skills in evaluating a work of literature. The critic must be trained in different branches of literature. A critic must serve a long apprenticeship in learning the fundamentals of his trade. For example, a critic of Shakespeare will not be able to write about the dramas of William Shakespeare confidently without having authority and a comprehensive knowledge of different kinds of dramas, the England of Shakespeare's age. A critic of Shakespeare must read the university wits, the Elizabethan theatre, stage, etc. All this technical information is essential for him, and its right use constitutes technical skill. The third quality of a critic is he should maintain a detached point of view. He should not allow his own preferences to influence his judgment. He should be unbiased and unprejudiced in his approach, and he should be able to rise above political, religious, and other considerations. A critic should not show any obvious bias to any writer, as Dr. Johnson did to Milton, or he should not show excessive fondness to any writer, as Dryden did to Chaucer. He should have sympathy for a work of art and try his best to give a fair criticism, even of something which he may personally dislike. The fourth quality of a critic is imaginative sympathy with the writer. A critic must have sympathy with the writer. He must imaginatively identify himself with the author and thus try to see things from the point of view of the writer. And he must be able to share the vision of life of the poet. It is only the real meaning and purpose of an author, and can impartially bring out the real significance of his work. The critic must have some imagination, some share of heavenly spark, then only otherwise he will utterly fail in his task. Imaginative writers like Hazlitt, Leigh Hunt, De Quincey, Coleridge, and Arnold are good critics. A good critic must always be close to the artist's point of view, and that he cannot do unless he himself has in him the poetic touch. Ben Jonson rightly observed, "To judge of poets is only the faculty of poets." Fifth quality of a good critic is a critic must possess a sound knowledge of human life, nature, and psychology. Literature mirrors life, so a thorough knowledge of life is essential for a correct judgment and evaluation of literature. A good and gifted critic must also have the philosophical mind. That is, he must be able to distinguish between reality and appearance. It is this capacity which made Hazlitt, De Quincey great critics. They had also the gift of communicating that distinction in the most appropriate language. So a critic must have the teaching or communicating capacity. He must have the capacity to expressing his ideas in a readable and appealing language. Some of the prominent critics like Dryden, John Ruskin, Hazlitt, Arnold, Walter Pater, John Ruskin, T.S. Eliot were illustrious writers of prose. Who is a good critic? According to Oscar Wilde, a good critic is he who is the true critic, but he who bears within himself the dreams and ideas and feelings of myriads of generations. A critic must have dreams, ideas, and feelings in his mind. Then only he can become a good critic. And a critic should not think that no thought is alien to him, and he must believe that no emotional impulse can obscure. And the critic is one who the true man of culture. Critic is the true man of culture, and he is the person who passes on the culture of previous generations to the future generations. He must have fine scholarship, and fastidious rejection has made instinct self-conscious and intelligent. A critic must be able to separate the work of art, and he must be able to distinguish between the good work and the bad work. The critic, by contact and comparison, makes himself master of the secrets of style and school, and understands their meanings and listen to their voice, and develops that spirit of disinterested curiosity which is the real root, and it is the real flower of the intellectual life, and thus attains to intellectual clarity, and having learnt the best that is known and thought in the world, lives with those who are immortals. Thus, the critic, he has to make a work immortal, then only he can be considered as a good critic. Thank you very much.